going away. Lord.
There is a candidate to put up on a bus. You see, and you have to leave. So I just want to put her before.
Praise God. Praise God.
Come on, 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 come on
Yes, sir.
No! Yeah!
rejoice.
Yes. Oh yes, oh yes. Yes.
And overnight just brought you with me. Just a short word. Baptism is a death unto sin.
Yes, praise the Lord.
And it is a new birth unto righteousness.
Oh, yes, oh, yes.
And when you go in another water and you come up, bury your old man.
Yes.
And when you come up, you put on a new man.
Yes.
Jesus walked 72 miles.
Yes.
Which none of us could have thought about that. He went to John to be baptized. But John said, I have not money. He stooped down and I'm loose. And I said, that is true. Jesus said to John, suffer with me so not fulfill our righteousness. He cometh to fulfill our righteousness. And John baptized Jesus in Jordan. And when he was coming up from the water, the Spirit of God descended like a dove.
Yeah.
And lighting up on his shoulder, and his voice said, this is my beloved son, whom
I am well pleased.
And the one unto Jesus already pleased the people who take baptism.
Oh, yeah.
The Bible says, repent, believe,
yeah,
and be baptized for what?
Remission of sin.
The wages of sin is death.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's eternal life. Like what he must say, how a man can be born when he's old, can he enter the second time?
No.
He that is born of the flesh,
his flesh,
born of the spirit,
his spirit.
How about that? I said that to thee,
he must
be born again.
So make up your mind going under the water.
Yes.
You are planted in the footsteps of Jesus.
Yes.
And it is time to put down the pulley arm of rebellion and fight against your body. Because we don't know when the rule is going to call.
No.
So seek it for the kingdom of God.
His righteousness.
Then all things
will be added unto thee.
We wish you God's speed. The Lord bless and keep you. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
One time we'll put our hands nicely into our pockets. We'll get it from our friends. After which, we'll have teacher Felicia to bring the evening announcement and the evening lesson. One time.
Amen.
The word. The word.
Everywhere he went, he was doing good. He's a mighty healer. He lends a hand.
When the people saw him, they saw him for
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Many of us would have had to give, and many of us did not have to give.
That's right.
But we trust God for His goodness and His mercy. And He has given us strength and courage that we will one day be able to go out and labor and bring in. So we are thanking Him for health and strength this evening. Father and God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we come before that presence again. We thank you for your goodness to us. Father, you have kept us alive and well. We are now here in your house, Lord, worshiping you. Help us, Lord, that all our worshiping will not be in vain, but that will come up to you as a sweet-smelling savor, and that will continue to bless us, that we can go and labor into the harvest field and bring into your house. Father, I ask you to bless all that was able to give, and even those that will not have to come. Father, I beg you in the name of Jesus Christ to help us with the responsibility to use this one, to use them for the purposes for which you want them. And even those who have given up their time to take this offering, I ask you to bless the name of God, the Father. We bless the name of God, the Son. And the name of God, the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Jesus is God.
Glory be to God.
Glory to God.
Before going to the message, I'll bring the announcement. I'm so pleased to be here once again to go to work with Pastor Jefferson, all the leaders, the mothers, and so the first announcement, which will be, there will be a Thanksgiving on the 23rd of June, which is next Sunday, which will be held here. And the dress code is supposed to be anything but on the spiritual clothes. The second announcement is Sister Leslie Ann will be having her 20th birthday Thanksgiving, which will be happening on Saturday, July the 27th at 1 p.m. And the dress code is pure white. And Sister Mary from Montreal will be having a Thanksgiving on the 11th of August, which will also be held here at the church. And the dress code is yellow and white. Also, the School of Wisdom will be having a Thanksgiving on the 30th of June, but I'm not too sure what time it was.
12 o'clock,
okay. And I heard that we're supposed to be having a church barbecue on the July 13th, but I don't have a time for that either. Let's go on.
But
after the
I didn't have any dealing with the tickets, them, and I got the tickets already. It will be on the 13th of July. It will be taking place at 81 Glasgow. But if you plan it, it's spelled Glasgow board and the tickets. So if anybody gets tickets and it's spelled with C, it's a G. It's Glasgow. So anybody who wants tickets, they can see me. And then just a reminder of the church anniversary, the material will be here by the end of the month. So just a reminder so that you guys will get all the money ready.
Yes.
Sister Ingrid, what time is the barbecue?
Oh, the barbecue.
2:30. Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Okay.
Done.
The first evening lesson was taken from Proverbs 8, verses 1 to 36. Second evening lesson was taken from Isaiah 5, from 1 to 18. And the foundation lesson was Acts 9, verses 1 to 20. But before I go into the message, I have to wish all the fathers a happy Father's Day. Honorably and spiritually, happy Father's Day. Yes, and I'm going to be talking about the story of Saul, which is a very moving Bible scripture that many of us may know and many of us may not know. And as in Acts chapter 9 from verse 1 to 20, shows the power of God and how our mistakes that we make could be the door opener for the living right for God.
Yes.
Many people may ask, how does the story of Saul relate to anything with Father's Day? Or what do I know about Father's Day because I'm not a father, nor am I a mother? Or how do I say that, what can a child teach about Father's Day? But as all these questions may be lingering in your head, I want you guys to think about it. I want you, brethren, to think about this question. What it is to define, like what it is to be a father. And as many of you may be thinking about, oh, maybe being a father is producing a child and being there for the child and whatsoever it be. It could go on forever and ever and etc. But what I know, my own knowledge, that the word father seems to describe many meanings. Just like said in Romans chapter 4, verse 16, therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all, which is showing the large responsibility of what a good father would carry or maintain. But when there is a good, there always has to be a bad. And when there's a bad, there's a good.
Yeah.
And in John chapter 8, verses 44, it says, ye are of your father the devil, and thus a father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and dwelleth not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Which clearly shows that there is a father of evil.
That's right.
But here a question I want to ask the fathers is, whose side are you leaning on?
Leaning on the Lord's side.
Leaning on the Lord's side.
God revealed unto me how I could interpret Acts 9, verse 1 to 20, for it to intertwine with this day. This scripture was given to me, or I say it came to me, a couple months back, and I knew that the youth day was coming up, and I was thinking maybe I should bring the message, but you know, sometimes when things happen, I'm giving all the youth a turn at the opportunity. And I was sitting there, and my mom told me that, oh, how could I write Father's Day service, and not the father, and so whatever, you know, all that. And she said, say so. And after I told my master, sitting there, I'm saying, oh, I'm not bothering to run no service again, because there's no point, right? But someone told me, get up and go get your laptop. So I was right there in the living room, and I flew up and got the laptop. And I come up there, and I said, well, what am I going to do with the laptop? After I said out loud, I'm like, come speak to me, because I am listening. And as I went to sit down, I sat there, and I had the scripture in front of me. And I'm like, the story of Saul, how can this relate to Father's Day? What, nothing can you talk about the father? How can I use this to bring a message? And as I began to type and read the scripture, try to understand it from my own, a voice came to me and said that the father of all will always make a way for his children. And as I was sitting there, I'm like, the father of all, what do you mean by that? And again, the voice said, the father of all will always make a way for the children. And I want to use that as a theme or like a topic, so before we go into it. But before I go into it, I want to talk about who Saul was. See, people know Paul as Saul, and people know Saul as Paul, but his Hebrew name was Saul. Saul. So I understand that. Saul. Saul was a Pharisee. Saul was a Pharisee, which is a member of the Jewish group. And they were observed and they were following the traditional and written law, where they were known to be superior and very holy. And Saul was very versed in the scripture, which made him a very eager and keen prosecutor. But in Acts 8, Saul was known to be the man who would ravage through the churches or enter into the homes of believers and committing them to prison. And all of the disbelief in Christ motivated him to not only arrest male Christians, which were known to be ringleaders or leaders that you will see, but he also locked up female believers as well, which it talks more of a briefing in it in Acts chapter 8, verses 3. But what I heard, and I always remember, is that in Psalm 105, verse 15, saying, touch not mine anointed and do my prophets no harm. Because God the Father of all says in Zechariah chapter 2, verse 8, for he that toucheth you, toucheth the apple of his eye.
That's right.
And because God the Father of all will always make a way for his children, that's exactly what he did to Saul. You see, many people within the church are just like Saul, including me. I'm just like Saul. Just like Saul, it gets you good. But many people believe that they're like David. They're humble and they're loving and they're God-fearing and they're so obedient and so trustworthy. But most of the time, they're just like Saul. I'm talking because I was just like Saul the same way too. I was very miserable. And you see, many of us, so I say we're just like Saul because many of us prosecute God's children when they're doing us no harm.
Amen.
But just like Saul, we are sitting up on this high horse and we think we know more than others because of our spiritual height. And we think we have the right to push someone's understanding out because we know the most.
That's right.
But because we believe our own understanding is better than others' understanding. But when we have a plan for ourselves, God always has a bigger one for his children.
That's right.
So God allows Saul to go on to the high priest to receive letters to Damascus and to synagogues, saying that whether if he found men or women, he will be able to bound them into Jerusalem. And in verse 3, Saul went upon his journey to Damascus to bound Christian believers. And just like any good father, when they find wrong something their child has been doing or they have done, they will stop them and correct the wrongs.
That's right.
And many of times their fathers are, do not correct the wrongs of their children because you really don't know any better. But here what happened. Right when Saul was off to do his own thing, a light shined around from heaven, and there was his signal. Right at this moment, God started to intervene. And for example, I'll use a modern day example. just like when many of us are small and we know our parents will cook that sweet pot. Mm-hmm. And we always, like, we're hungry and we eat and they give us our serving and they serve all other children, but how do food so sweet, you want more?
Yeah.
And if that means that the girl will wake up in the middle of the night to go to eat mommy sweet pot, you will wake up another night.
That's right.
But sometimes when we go to eat mommy sweet pot, mommy here and you get up from the bed, and she go, as soon as you hear that, that is your signal, thou shalt not steal,
that's
and you go back into bed. Right? That's one of the signals I use as a morning text.
Mm.
But in that moment, when the light shone around him, Saul fell. And here it is. I heard the voice of Jesus say,
Lord.
I am
It is hard for Jesus against the prick.
Yes.
And hear that line? I am Jesus who passes through the dick.
Amen.
It's harder for thee to kick against the prick.
Yes.
What is a prick? Well, a prick is known to be the pointed stick that is used to urge stubborn animals to move. The stick was known to be made up out of wood or metal, and when the animals refused to move or would be back at that pointed stick, as a result, it would stop them for this and force them to move forward and not backwards. So, when the party says it's hard for you to kick against the prick, I'm putting it into more of a modern day context, is that God told Saul that he was only hurting himself in his effort to eliminate Christians. Because he is unknowingly a holy God. And it made no sense for Saul to such a God. Here is where you can see the meekness within Saul. Because here he is, face to face with the Father beginning and end. The God who created him and could destroy him.
Yeah.
And that high horse that Saul was once upon is no longer there.
Oh, yeah.
And he had no choice but to climb up that horse.
Yeah.
Because no one is better than God who created us.
Oh, yes.
God breathed his air within our lungs, and then it was forget that we have someone bigger than us.
Yes.
And when Saul knew that he was no longer up there, he's down there.
Oh, yeah. Reach it,
because most times how you see God determines how you hear God, and it actually shows us the high authority God has above him.
Yes.
And in verse 6, it says, he trembled and he's astonished and says, Lord, what would thou have me to do?
To do,
praise and the
God.
Lord, yes. Arise, that go to the city, and she told thee what thou must do. And the men that dreamed with Saul were speechless because themselves had heard a voice.
Jonah
rode the boat.
Oh, Let him live.
But there was a certain disciple
Ananias, God came to the vision, saying, Ananias, and he answered, Behold, I am here, Lord.
Amen.
And a voice unto him, Arise, go into the street, which is called Strength, and inquired in the house of Judas, of the one called Malatura, for before he prayed.
Amen.
He prayed, seeing the moments of Saul going out, and he was complaining to God about all the sheep coming to him. He prayed. He Saul was going to be a man who persecuted his children, the same flesh and blood of himself. And God disciplined him and turned him into a chosen vessel. So today you're feeling like Saul. Amen. I'm going to remind you from a quote from James chapter 1, verses 21 to 23. I took it from an International Children's Bible for a better understanding. And it says, so put out of your life every evil thing and every kind of wrong you do. Don't be proud, but accept God's teaching that planted in your heart. This teaching can save your souls. Do what God's teaching says. Do not just listen and do nothing. You only sit and listen. You are fooling yourself. A person who hears God's teaching and does nothing is like a man looking in a mirror. So, if God could do what he has done to somebody like Saul, who persecuted his children, what makes us any different? So by just hearing the word and not doing what it says, will not make you any better than anyone else. As the saying goes, be careful who you point your fingers at. Be more pointing right back at you. As in 2 Chronicles chapter 30, verses 8 to 9 says, now be yet not stiff-necked as your fathers were, but yield yourself unto the Lord and enter into the sanctuary, which he has sanctified forever, and serve the Lord your God, that the fierceness of his wrath may turn away from you. For if ye turn again unto the Lord, your brethren and your children shall find compassion before them that lead them captive, so that they shall come again into his land. For the Lord your God is gracious and merciful, and will not turn away his face from you if you return unto him.
Amen.
Which means that if you turn away from all the things that trouble you, and turn away from persecuting your brothers and your sisters, today from spreading stories on the internet and conference on the commerce, turn away from it all, because the Father is willing to attend unto his children and protect them from any harm and danger, because God is the Father of all, and he will always make a way for his children.
That's right.
And then come to the end.
Praise the Lord.